we all know what a compiler is. But have you ever wondered how they work and what are they capable of doing? In order to make this video, I got some help from a guy that works on compilers professionally. Go thank him by following his Mastodon for cat pictures. And I got some very interesting things to talk about. And we'll dive deep into the inner workings of the compiler. Have you ever seen this party trick where I can force the compiler to completely skip an if statement? I'll explain it. And there are many things that a compiler can do and cannot do, and many myths to debunk. I know this video is long, but if you watch it, trust me, you'll find a lot of interesting information, so let's go. Let's say you have a programming language like C. Your computer can't read C code, so you need a compiler to turn your C code into what are called machine instructions. These are instructions that your CPU knows how to execute, and they are in binary. If you have ever heard about assembly is basically a human-readable form of machine code. If you turn each assembly instruction into its binary representation, and some extra small steps, you get to machine code. Now, it is not an easy task to write a C compiler. And the worst part is that after you make your C compiler, it will only work on the architecture that you made it for. So that can be x86, for example. But if you want your code to compile on Apple, for example, that now uses ARM chips. Or let's say you want to write some C code for a car microcontroller. Those also use a different architecture. So you need to do this tedious process for every programming language to turn it into every single possible CPU architecture. How would you solve this problem? Well, here is where LLVM comes into play. LLVM works like this. They created an imaginary assembly language called LLVM-IR, and they created a compiler for it that can compile on many platforms. Then, if you want to make a compiler, you just need to compile your language to LLVM-IR, and from there, LLVM has already implemented heavy optimizations and other hard things for all their supported platforms. So, the idea of this LLVM-IR is that it is language agnostic and platform agnostic, so it can sit in between the programming language and the hardware that you aim to compile to. And they even have a library to help you generate LLVM-IR. So basically, a lot of the compiler was already done for you. This has many benefits. If someone creates a new CPU architecture, they just need to implement one compiler here to support all the languages that already use LLVM. And if someone implements some crazy optimization into LLVM, now suddenly, all the other compilers that use LLVM will get this upgrade. Now, keep in mind that not all compilers use LLVM. Rust compiler, Z compiler, and Clang C compiler use LLVM, but others are built from the ground up. So, this LLVM sounds cool, but it is not magic. In order for the compiler to be able to optimize your code, he needs to understand what you want it to do. So let's take a break from compilers inner workings and look at an example. Let's say you have this function in C++ that takes a number as a string. So you convert it into an integer and then write some data back into another buffer. Now you can easily see as a human that this repeated call to convert to int is redundant here. And the compiler can also see that too. But can the compiler actually remove the redundant call here? Think about it. Is there any situation where it wouldn't be correct to rewrite the code like this? Well, yes, if the input is modified somewhere in the middle of the function. But you will say, okay, but the input is never modified, right? Well, here I'm writing to the output. But what if, for the output variable, someone passed the same input variable? Then I would modify the input here if these two pointers were the same. I know, that isn't the case, but the compilers can't know that. In C, you have a way to tell the compiler that the two pointers don't interfere with one another. This information will be used by the compiler to optimize your code. But in the C++ standard, you don't have that, and that can hurt optimizations. There is a fix for this, but we'll talk about it later. So, as long as the compiler has all the information it needs, it can do crazy optimizations. So, for example, the C++ compiler compiles its CPP file separately, and then it merges them together during the linking process. So if a function is external, that means it is in a different CPP file, the compiler can't possibly know anything about it. So in this example, if this function is external, the compiler can't know that given the same input, the function returns the same value to optimize it. That's why modern compilers have what is called link time optimization, where after they compile all the units, they optimize them together one more time. This optimization might not be on by default if you compile from the CLI, so you might want to look into that. And the compilers are very smart. Some of them even know about the Gauss sum. So these two pieces of code are equivalent, because there is a mathematical formula called the Gauss sum that looks like this, and it can be used. And the compiler knows about it. It can literally remove this for loop for you. So that's why I get angry when I hear people give some advice to write a bit shift instead of dividing by 2. If you didn't know, for integers, bit shifting to the right one bit is equivalent to dividing by 2, but faster. But the compiler will always make this optimization for you when you have optimizations turned on. And there are some people that don't trust compilers. And there can be bugs for sure, but that's very unlikely. As I said in this video, you should care more about code readability most of the time, because that's more important than a 0.1% chance you'll get a slightly faster program. And there are many optimizations, like the compiler can reorder the for loops in order to get some better performance, and even crazier things that I will talk about later. But as already discussed, it needs to have all the information available to it in order to optimize. So I gave you the example with division by 2 earlier, but for floating point numbers, there are very strict rules about what optimizations the compiler is allowed to make, unless you specify otherwise. So there are some flags for that that you can look up if you are curious. And you'll see the advice online that compilers are way smarter than humans, and that you should never try to outsmart them. Well, I honestly saw that advice only from people that don't know much about this topic. And advanced programmers will usually tell you that you need to help the compiler a lot if you want the best optimized code. Not having many abstractions, for example, is a way to do that. And if you want to optimize, you need to measure the speed of your code and read some assembly sometimes. The compiler sometimes fails to optimize some code into SIMD. That means to use some instructions that do more stuff at the same time. But other times, trying to write that yourself will get a worse result. So if a part of the code is very important to be fast, you may need to check the compiler's assembly output and maybe optimize it yourself if needed. So compilers can be smarter than humans as long as they have all the information that they need. And I'll show later some optimizations that no human can do. But if you still don't believe me that compilers aren't always better than humans, in this video, a lead Google engineer shows how something as simple as a unique pointer isn't optimized as well as if you were to use a normal pointer. Okay, let's go back to compiler architecture. So the first part of any compiler is called the frontend, and its role is to read the source code and construct a graph-like structure out of it, called the abstract syntax tree. I made a toy programming language at some point, called C++, and in the video about it, I talk about these things. Now, we will focus on the other parts of the compiler. And after the source code passes through the frontend, it will be transformed into LLVM IR. From here, the backend of the compiler is actually split into two parts. So the first part is sometimes called the middle end, and the last part is the backend. Don't worry, it will all make sense in the end. So from LLVM IR, the middle end will also produce LLVM IR, but optimized. And this is where a lot of optimizations happen, but not all of them. And another interesting detail to note is that these LLVM IR blocks of code are organized into a tree-like structure. So you probably have seen this example. This function should have an if statement with two return values, but the compiler optimizes it into a function that always returns 69 lmao. Where has all my code gone? Well, here I am dereferencing a null pointer, and that in C++ is called undefined behavior. And undefined behavior is not allowed to happen, so the compiler will construct a graph that might look something like this. And this block of code will always lead to undefined behavior, so it can be marked by the compiler as unreachable. So it will be simply completely removed. Let me show you something even cooler, and you can test that yourself. So by going to the Compiler Explorer website, make sure you enable optimizations here, and you can test to see if all compilers produce the same result. And if you go here and select opt pipeline, you can see all the passes that LLVM takes if you are on the clean compiler. You can select to only see passes that modify the code, and all the passes before this line are the middle end. And you can see that there is a lot happening in the backend, so you'll get there. But here you can see the exact pass where the compiler removed the if code completely. The pass is called simplify CFG pass. So basically, it simplifies this graph. Okay, now the backend takes this LLVM IR and converts it into almost assembly code, called MIR. And from here on, the backend is platform specific, and the backend has a lot of work to do, turning the LLVM IR into actual machine code for an actual CPU. LLVM IR has, for example, unlimited registers, while a normal CPU doesn't. And assigning registers is similar to the coloring problem. And you might recognize that the coloring problem is MPA complete, so that's hard on its own, and it is just scratching the surface of why assigning registers is very difficult. Good that LLVM has us covered. So the frontend is language specific, The middle-end is language and platform independent, and the backend is platform specific. And the cool part about this is that the compiler knows a lot about the CPU that you try to compile to. It knows how long it takes one operation and how multiple operations work together to come up with exactly the best optimization for the current architecture. If an architecture has a fuse multiply add instruction, it will use that instruction here, instead of using a multiply and an add separately. Intel has, for example, cryptographic functions, so a good backend will use those if it recognizes that some code can be replaced by those instructions, though it is something significantly harder than a fuse multiply add, so you might need to call those functions by hand if you want that optimization. But a modern CPU has thousands of instructions, and your program is also huge. And this is a thing that humans can do on a mass scale. The compiler will change your code into better instructions, and if you give him a specific processor to work with, the compiler will literally order the instructions in the best possible way for that specific CPU to be used as best as possible. This dives into CPU pipelining and ports, but if you want to learn about those things, watch this video and part 2 of it. You won't believe how much you will learn there. And for something like a game where you need the best performance possible, people need to sometimes spend time reading the assembly and helping the compiler produce a better result. But that takes time, and the improvements are not always big. But to optimize well, the compiler of course needs to have all the information possible. So to make a good compiler, you need to feed LLVM with as much information as possible. The C++ standard doesn't have the restrict keyword, for example, but many compilers have it as an internal keyword, or this unreachable keyword that tells the compiler that it's impossible to reach a certain point in the compilation. This can help the compiler optimize the code a lot, and there are a ton of attributes like this to look into. But be very careful, because if you put an attribute like this wrongly, you'll get a horrible bug, so especially if you are a beginner, don't use them. And also, they are compiler specific. And finally, we get into the code gen step, and that means turning this assembly code into actual binary code. The compilers are extremely smart, and I hope you will look weird at people from now on when they tell you that by using a bit shift instead of a divide by 2, you can outsmart the compiler. That's why I also didn't believe that switching is faster than if, because if you just need to convert the code from a switch to an if, the compiler could also easily do that for you. And in fact, Clang will internally teach switches and ifs in the same way. So I found out that even though it is possible to get a slightly faster switch, both switch and if will have a jump table, so you'll never have a big performance difference from changing an if to a switch, as people say online, that the if needs to make every single check. That's not true for modern compilers, so you should check this video if you want to see the full picture. See you there!